Greetings, ladies and gentlemen. This is Stan, Stan the Radio Man, and this is another edition of Interesting Ideas brought to you by the What It Takes Radio Company. We're in the business of helping you reach your audience. That's right. Everybody has to have an audience to make it in life and career today. Reach your audience. Bring your message to life and then distribute it all around the world. That's what we do. We do it well. And as we've mentioned, it just could be, it could give you a touch of immortality. As I pointed out to one of my friends who has a young daughter, I said there's a very, very good chance that 50 years from now, your daughter is going to find that her dad did some rather fascinating and interesting radio programs. They'll still be around somewhere on the internet, and you know what? She'll share them with her children and maybe grandchildren, and yes, that was my father. Wise, bright, funny, clever, smart old man. He's gone now. I miss him greatly, but that's part of your heritage. And, of course, if your stories continue, that is at least a touch of immortality. That's what we do. We do it well. And one of the things we are offering is a way for you to record a private radio program, a private video. You've heard of leaving a legacy letter? No, don't leave a legacy letter. Leave a storytelling adventure for your children and grandchildren. And we can help you do that. So that's what I do, along with a lot of things. What this was all about is I discovered, now I knew, of course, the story, and I knew there was something that it was sometimes celebrated, but this is a holiday. Now, it's not one that most people are familiar with, except that there are millions of people, maybe even in this audience, who, yeah, that's a holiday, all right, Stan. Thank you for getting that right. It is called, here I go now, here we go, Eid al-Adha. Eid al-Adha, or sometimes it's pronounced Eid al-Adha, you know, however it turns out. And it is today a major holiday, and it is about the killing of children. Oh my goodness, what could that be about? Well, that's coming up on the program today. The program is truly interesting and perhaps something we can learn about life and business even today. Program begins right now. Some of you are already into it, but here we go. Now, within both the, all three, within the Quran of the Muslims, within the Bible, the Holy Bible of the Christians, and in the Hebrew scriptures, there is a common story. It's in the book of Genesis in the Hebrew scriptures, which of course is also a part of the Christian scriptures and tradition. Yeah, you may be going along fine, and all of a sudden you come to Genesis 22, and bang! You get hit right across the head. Now, what happened is that a man called Abram is called by God thousands of years ago, and God comes to him and says, it's time to do what the God of the universe is all about. And you have been chosen to bring the word, the people of God, into being. You are going to, you and your wife are going to have children, and they're going to be like stars in the sky. Well, that is, in the tradition, both of Jews and of Christians, the founding, the beginning of the Jewish people, the ones chosen by God to bring God into the world. Yeah, and it's quite a story because both Abraham and Sarah, his wife, are quite old, you know. And they didn't have in vitro fertilization or anything like that at that time. So there's really no hope. What is this all about? Well, she does get pregnant and brings forth a son, and his name is Isaac. And there had been complications before that led to other children, but they were not from Sarah. Yeah, so all of this is the story. And, of course, Isaac is deeply loved by his mother and father. And then we find that all of a sudden God says to Abraham, take your son Isaac and sacrifice him. You've got to make a sacrifice to God. You kill a lamb and then you burn the lamb as a offering to God. But don't take a lamb. This time, take your very own son. Now, what in the world? What kind of God are we talking about who is talking about killing your own son? Well, the story is that that's exactly what he went out to do. And I would encourage you to read the story. And I think you all know that that's not what happened. But what in the world is going on here that God, the God of love, the God of the universe, wants us to kill an innocent child as a sacrifice to him? What's going on? Well, this holiday is celebrated primarily by the people of the Muslim faith. That's what it is. It's the festival, the celebration, more be the commemoration of sacrifice. The fact that you have to sacrifice things to God that are really, really important to you, that living a life of faith is one of sacrifice. And by the way, all of the traditions believe that, but it is the Muslim faith that really commemorates that with a special holiday, holy day. And this happens to be the day that they do that. Well, of course, there have been hundreds of thousands, if not millions, of sermons and stories trying to explain this rather strange phenomenon. Now, the Muslim tradition primarily subscribes to the idea is that it's obedience. You know, we got to obey God. You know, even in the Quran, it says that Abraham even told, Isaac what was going to happen. And Isaac said, well, yeah, I guess you got to do that. Now, that's not necessarily the way the story is framed in other traditions. But, yeah, that's the deal. Why is that? Well, is it obedience? Is it faith that he knew that maybe it's going to turn out anyhow? But you can find hundreds of messages about the faith of Abraham, the obedience of Abraham, and perhaps a way to make this story make sense in whatever tradition or non-tradition you have. And of course, I encountered people who were, of course, not happy with it. Then, you know, one person said to me, "That's quite a God you dumb people worship that goes around asking us to kill our kids. You know, what kind of religion is that? What kind of God is that?" And you then try and explain it, and it perhaps is kind of hard to do. Well, I'm just going to suggest, and I think this is not original with me, but it really helped me. You see, if you know the tradition of that times, if you know the history, things had degenerated. Child sacrifice was very common in that world. Yeah. Children were routinely killed and sacrificed to appease the gods. You literally oftentimes would offer your dearest children as a sacrifice, as an offering, to make sure that God is on your side, and that he will do good things for you and not do bad things for you. Human sacrifice is very, very common in the traditional religions of the ancient world, and for long times. The Aztec Inca civilizations that existed in North America. Human sacrifice was quite traditional as a way of assuring a good crop or of assuring the pleasure of the gods. It was not unheard of, particularly in Abraham's time, that that's what you might have to do. And, well, I guess we have to do it too. I think the message is quite simple. What God is saying is, we don't do that anymore. No, we don't do that. That's not what I'm about. That's what other people are about. And that's what you think God is all about. And that's what you probably think I'm all about. But I'm not about that. I'm about something else. And of course, the story, particularly in the Hebrew tradition, the Christian tradition, kind of alludes to the fact that when the young boy said, well, okay, we got all the stuff to start a fire. Well, where's the animal we're going to slay or the animal we're going to kill? And the story says that Abraham said, well, God will provide one. Well, it could be that Isaac was the provided one, as far as maybe he knew. I don't know. But the story ends that a ram is caught, a goat is caught, an animal is caught, and that's what happened, is just before he's ready to kill his own son, a messenger comes from heaven and says, stop that, that's not what we're supposed to do. My goodness, you truly are a man of faith and trust, but that's not what we do anymore. It's not about killing children. And of course, later on, we all learn. One of the wonderful things I love about the new film series called The Chosen is that it doesn't begin with the traditional way of, you know, the angel saying Mary's going to have a child and the birth of Jesus. It actually begins with the story of Jesus as a grown man who's starting his ministry. And one of the things he does is before he even begins, he's starting to become friends to children. It seems that, at least in that story version, that some of his first followers, or the people who were first enchanted with him, were the children. And of course, one of the world-famous hymns is, you know, Jesus loves the little children. Jesus loves all the children of the world. Red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus loves the children of the world. And, of course, now the ceremonies are very different. We don't kill the children. We baptize them, or we bring them to God and offer them and give God thanks for them. It doesn't appear that child sacrifice is very common anymore, though who knows what might exist in some of the darker parts of the world. But let's not be careless about that. That's part of the reason I have a problem with unlimited abortion. Just do, you know. It's a child. It's a child that God loves. And it didn't survive the abortion. Of course, they never do. Just, you know, maybe we ought to think twice about what we're really doing. Maybe it isn't just about reproductive rights. Maybe it's about the children. Also, I also know that that in many cases, as I've discovered in some of my work, that every day, in fact, someone pointed out, they think that every 6 seconds, one two, three, four, five, six. That possibly, somewhere in the world, a child dies of malnutrition or hunger. Could that be true? Could it be that we actually spend more on our pets, on dog food and grooming for our pets, that if the same amount of money would be put in a place where we could make sure that every child had enough to eat, there would be more than enough, both for the food and the distribution, if we just had at least the same amount of money that we do for pet care that we might have for child care. I'm the father of two children. Nothing is more precious to me than my children. And obviously, I speak for billions of people around the world and for many of those who've lost children and grieve, for those who want children and can't and grieve even more. That's why both Mother's Day and Father's Day are always a little bit bittersweet for some people. It could be that Mom or Dad were not the best, for sure. And it could be that hundreds and thousands of millions of wannabe fathers and wannabe mothers don't get to enjoy that wonderful opportunity due to something else. But that's a story for today. This is the day we celebrate, commemorate, or at least take notice of the holiday that reminds us, maybe, that we don't do that anymore. We don't do that to our children. Jesus does love all the children of the world, and we should love and help them flourish too. Just maybe. That's what the message and the story and the commemoration is all about. If I can be helpful to you, if you'd like to respond to me, reach out to me at stanhusted@gmail.com, stanhusted@gmail.com. We've got a lot of good things to talk about tomorrow or maybe Wednesday. We're going to talk about a gentle invitation to exhale. Yeah, wonderful woman has written a book about how to live slowly and a gentle invitation to exhale. All the best to you, stanhusted@gmail.com. Let me know how I can help you build a business, build a radio program, how to live better now. And bye for right now.